the next part, part two of the defense session. This is questions and answers from the opponents and the PhD students. Still a student, remember?
Yes.
Actually, the procedure says I should ask you to stand up, but I think that's a, that must be an obsolete thing.
I will do when you finish talking. Can we say that?
Or when you have had the question, maybe.
Okay, good.
Yeah. It's some stupid moves. But, okay, I have learned that the sequence of opponents posing the questions should be first Sumi Nenonen, and after that Geir Hansen, and last Susanne Hölfgenissen. So, I've also learned that you expect to use about maximum 40 minutes for your part of the session. So let's see what happens. That's the plan, at least.
Yes, thank you very much. Congratulations, Aneta, PhD student, for the very nice and inspiring presentation. So we were able to see that you are deep in your topic and you know more than any of us about the topic you have been working for many years. So it's an honor to be here. Thank you for this possibility. And as well, all of us have been working with the topic of usability of workplaces, usability of built environment. And we are very happy to include your PhD to the becoming an updated research agenda of usability of workplaces, which is an international research community. So that has provided me as well the opportunity to follow your research during these years. And it will be very interesting to have this discussion now with you. And the agenda will be as follows. So I will start with the questions and being interested in how you are, how did you find the topic and what is your motivation and the reasoning behind your research questions and some questions connected to methods as well. And from there on, Geir will start with theories. And then Susan will then dive into case studies and the contributions of the practice and academic community. So that are the this is how we are going to spend this afternoon, and I hope we will get the interesting discussion and keep also the audience awake. I think you will stay awake.
I think so.
So you have been aiming with your PhD to extend the research in usability of buildings to include all building phases, defining the process model and methods of usability briefing. And your research results generate a better understanding of how knowledge about user needs can be fed into briefing and design processes, and they contribute then to the research of usability of buildings. So let's start with the first question, which is from the cover page, the name of your thesis. It is Usability Briefing for Hospital Design, Exploring User Needs and Experiences to Improve Complex Buildings. So tell me your opinion, how well the name of this thesis and the content of the thesis match with each other. And now you need to stand up.
Yes. That is a very, very good question, because I have been changing the title many, 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 many times. So that, I think the title is a kind of, some kind of, how do you say, a middle way to try to combine all the things I have been doing without the title being a page long. So I needed to both kind of exclude some things and maybe put some of the things in the pill. So maybe the, should we go back to the title page and you all see. So the usability briefing, is what I want to develop, that you saw the model of usability briefing. So I think that everybody can accept that it's defining what is inside of the thesis. For hospital design, that was changed many times because I'm not only focusing on design, but people often refer to designing hospitals of the whole process of the building project as design. And hospital, because I had most of the cases with hospitals, but the model could be used to other, as I say, complex buildings as well. But here, we, because it's based on hospital projects, then let's say it's for hospital design. So far, so good, I hope.
Yes.
And then exploring user needs. As I said before, previously in the title, I had the word capturing user needs. But that would mean that there is some one need to be found that will be capturing the existing need that is just there waiting to be found. Whereas exploring is maybe fitting better to the process, how it actually looks. You have to explore it maybe together with the users, because if you ask them what they want, they will just give you a number of things they know and just more of it. Oh, we have those rooms that we just need them bigger or more of them. So it's kind of exploring the needs. So it's all those processes where we can find out how we can make it the process together better. To have the building that will satisfy the needs in the future. That is why the word exploring. So the user needs is a big part of it, of the usability briefing. In experiences, they are of course connected with the needs, because when you experience something in the, for example, you can evaluate the experiences with the building, the existing building, but you can also plan the future experiences. Well, you know, when you know the needs. And improve complex buildings, that's a hope. If you do things as I propose in this model, then you hopefully improve the building. So maybe the buildings might on the first sight look similar to another building that has not been using that kind of complex process, but then maybe will be improved to the people that are going to use it. And complex buildings, because hospitals are complex buildings, and also that the model could, or we can improve not only hospitals, but any kind of complex buildings. So, have I answered your question?
Yes, you did. And in a very good and analytical way, as the real research has. But I'd like your expression that you are somewhere in the midway, because it's always the arts, how you can say things in a very like summarized way. Mm. But I think you really, really know your topic. And what was a little bit like I was thinking and writing down when you had your good presentation, that you wanted to, or your outcome is a process model. And within this title, you have already kind of nearly three different processes, like briefing and designing and exploring. So it's
yes.
Like in the future how you can put it to be the process, and what is then the what is helping the process to be your great model. So that's very nicely said, that you are in kind of in the midway. And as said, the dear child has many names, so that's one part of the process. But I know that the Danish language is not a native language, neither for you or me. No, me, but there you have brugervänlig, and that means user-friendly.
Yeah, I don't
so
like
why did you do that?
Yeah, I don't like the word, but that was the Danish native speakers telling me that that is the word.
Yeah.
And all the other words that I was inventing are not understandable.
Yeah.
So that was a compromise.
Yeah.
To even bigger extent than the English one.
Yeah. But that's like really, the discussion what we have had in usability of workplaces is cool.
Because
that
it's
some
not
of the
English
same. Word are
the usability is not the same as user friendliness.
Yeah.
As you can guess.
Yeah. But then we go further for your motivation. So tell me or tell us what interests you in usability briefing and complex buildings, and especially in the context of hospital. What is your interest? Mm-hmm.
So for the first, I have a deep interest in buildings, and then just a strong interest in users and how well the buildings can support the users, because I have both been designing buildings and experiencing many buildings that are not completely satisfying my, as a user, needs. And maybe all of you have some experiences like that, where you just arrive to the elevator and it's not accessible because there's a step towards it, and you have a bike and it's impossible. For example, that was a just example, but there's many different things that can be not usable. So my interest is how the buildings not only can be more beautiful, because that is many architects that are really good at, but how can they actually really support the things that are going on to happen in them? So that is my very deep personal motivation.
And you can see the interest when you have been like writing about and researching the topic.
Yeah. So now, of course, while I was starting researching, then I knew more about all the different types of processes that can maybe help that.
Yeah.
And I was learning about them and tried to combine all of those that I thought might be useful, or I saw that are useful in some of the case studies.
Yeah. So tell us also, like, what was the choice? How did you choose your topic? If you mm-hmm. go back to a few years back mm-hmm. to those first ideas, so how did you come to select your topic?
Yes. So 5 years ago, or 5.5 years ago, when I was studying, I was having just as strong need for the usable buildings as now. But of course, I didn't know all those research things so well. Well, it has all started with the process that I was working as an architect, and I saw many of the buildings we were doing. We were, of course, as many other architects, rushing a little, didn't have time, for example, for evaluations. So we never knew if the buildings we did are actually good for people. We thought so, because we were, of course, user-centered, but we never asked any user, and we seldom, no, I cannot say never, but we seldom visited the buildings afterwards and saw how they're working. And that was one of the inspirations for me. Okay, something maybe can be done better. Maybe if architects, because I am one, or maybe others also involved, do some other things differently, maybe we'll have more buildings that are actually satisfying the user needs. So that was my inspiration. Then I actually took a course by Pear in facilities management. And it was very interesting, a little new topic, combining people, places, and processes. Per proposed, I was searching for PhD students, and I said, oh, I could maybe try to do something like that. And we specified the topic more detailed, and I started.
Yeah.
So that has been a very short summary. Yeah.
Short summary and interesting summary, but if I'm very sarcastic mm-hmm. and I ask, is there anything special interesting in researching that topic?
Everything is interesting for me, but of course we can ask the public if they think it's interesting. Is it interesting?
Okay, so that's the Facebook kind of thing. Ah, very clever, very clever. So let's move forward to definitions, and if you should now say, for example, 3 or 5 keywords of your thesis, so what would they be?
Usability, very important. Briefing, user involvement. How many more?
There were 3, 2 that can, two yeah. more.
Innovation, boundary objects.
All right. Mm-hmm. Then I would, I think that you will be discussing with Geir about the innovation, but why did you choose boundary object?
Well, it was partly because we were testing those many different methods in this healthcare innovation lab. And then part of us was researchers, so we were seeking inspiration for what are the different object methods. And then we found out, okay, there is something, and people call it boundary objects, all those different methods and tools. And then we could search for some more.
Yeah.
So that was the start. I didn't know about boundary objects before I started this.
All right, so that's the interest. So now there is one word queuing in the door.
Mm-hmm.
It's hospital,
yes,
or healthcare sector.
Yes.
So why did you leave that out from the keywords?
Now? Oh, didn't I not? Oh, sorry, I forgot that.
Okay.
That could be one of them.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then, as you said, you are interested in hospital design, and you have gathered your data from the healthcare sector. And then you have these interesting complex buildings, and you have very nicely told that this is something what can be applied in complex buildings. So can you please define what is complex building?
Mm-hmm. I think I wrote it in the thesis, citing a couple of others. Now I have to remember myself. But many researchers have been defining what is a complex building. But what I remember right now is complex. It could be both complex because of many different functions happening there. And we can see that in hospitals there is many different departments. And each of the department has anyway many different functions, many different kinds of users. That could be another one. Many different functions, many different users. There can also be many different technologies involved. Some of the hospital things are very complex because you make some scanning room, then you need to do some many different kinds of shielding. You need to be an expert in so many different things that nobody can do it single-handedly. There's always many companies, and each of the company will have many experts in specific fields. So you could say they are complex. I think that will be those three things.
Yeah, yeah, it's very understandable. You were talking a lot about in these cases that when you had user involvement processes, they were starting to think about their work processes as well.
Mm-hmm.
So if you compare, for example, healthcare organization to some other organization
mm-hmm.
which is functioning,
mm-hmm.
in complex buildings. How do you estimate, is the healthcare organization, hospital organization, more complex than other organizations in other complex buildings?
Mm-hmm.
What is your opinion of that?
Let's take another complex building. Let's say hotel. It's, you would say, pretty simple, but if you look at the organization, it can be pretty complex too with all those things and cleaning and things on time, and so it could also be seen as complex. There's also backstage and front stage, but they are not having that many types of users. Of course, they have different types of people coming there, but they're all kind of behaving the same way. Unlike in hospitals, you have kind of even more complex picture of the different kinds of patients and their relatives, and they might come with kids. So the complexity is just, it's not like all the other buildings are not complex, but this one is just has one more level of complexity extra because they have all the different departments and all the different types of illnesses and patients.
Yeah, but that would be a nice perspective in the future. Can there be a complex building with not so complex organization and users, and What kind of different segments you can find out from there? But
yeah, so the complexity can be on many different kind of fields. There can be complex organization or complex processes or complex picture of all the types of users and probably more.
Yeah, exactly. So then we can move to your research questions. There
mm-hmm.
are... There are two main research questions.
Yes.
How can usability briefing be conducted, and what should the process include? There. So, do you state that this is one question?
That was maybe cheating a little. you could say that what should the process include is already part of the question. How can it be conducted? Like, this is kind of just explaining a little more what I mean.
Yeah.
It is one question.
Yeah.
What it includes is how.
So how is the main word there? And as well, the how is also in the second question, how to capture.
Yes.
I wanted to point this out because it's always the reason when you set your research question according to your goals. That's the way how you choose your methods.
Exactly.
So if you can with how question end up to the method which is also helping you to understand what should the process mm-hmm. include, then mm-hmm. it's fully all right. But this is the one thing to point out that it's
yeah,
the
both
art
of them
to
start with how.
Yeah.
Also now when you're leading to the method, then it was the case study that was written by many others. I think Yun wrote that case study is very good at answering questions how and why.
Yeah.
So now I have the how, and case study is good at showing some possibilities how.
Yeah.
And
then you had a huge amount of sub-questions. We don't go there at the moment, but then some definitions still connected to these research questions. So you have the user need and experiences. You have been talking already about them when we were talking about your title, but could you one more time define the user need and user experience?
Mm-hmm. So need as things we either wish for or maybe not even are aware of, but are needing to do what we're supposed to do if it's work, or need if you're a patient and you need maybe to sit down while you're waiting. So that is a need, and there can be many different types of need. And experience would be, we can of course plan the experience or evaluate the experience. So we can evaluate if the experience of the patient, let's say, is what kind of experience is it? Is it a good experience? Oh, there's a table or chair I can sit on. It's very pleasant here. I'm not getting nervous about this doctor I'm going to see in a second. That would be an experience. Whereas the need would be rather, oh, I need to sit down before I get to the doctor. But both the need and experience, I think, can not only be evaluated but also planned for. We can plan a better experience for both the doctor and the patient.
Yeah.
That's what I believe in.
Yeah. So there is the whole school of experience design
mm-hmm.
connected to service design.
Yeah.
But so far there isn't any need design because
uh-huh.
it's much more like in your, of course, in the literature of marketing you can
mm-hmm.
like have theories which are like creating needs which you might not have.
Yeah.
And that's the
yeah, as Ph.D said, that if I
yeah.
ask the people what they want, they would say, I want a faster horse. They would not say, I want a car. That
yeah.
would be Ph.D.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
in that way, he designed a need. That also we can do when we do the user-driven innovation in hospitals. We can design a new need that can maybe help some other processes.
Yeah. And if you now think of your case studies, so if you should somehow like describe, is there a need or the experience which is in the bigger role, or are they in the similar role? So if you should just say
mm-hmm.
what happened in different case studies, were they like experience driven or need driven,
mm-hmm.
if you think about users there?
Yeah. I think just to start in general terms, I think in all the cases the need is stronger because it's kind of more objective, more acceptable to have needs than to have wishes for the experiences. So the experience is kind of the luxus, luxury need, kind of. But but that said, I could also say that even though that was maybe the standard, there was also, I saw in the cases, in all of them, this experience in all of them. So, for example, in the Bispebier, now when I talked about this garden thing, they were not only talking about needs because they kind of don't need the garden. You don't need the garden for the hospital, but there is the experience. The patients would see the trees, they, as also literature says that they will maybe be sooner out of the hospital. And it is good for both for the patients, but also for the people working there to look at nature. So that will be kind of experience. So they put a lot of effort on that. And in the case in Trondheim, there was also more on experience, focus on experience. And I haven't been to all those workshops with the users, so I don't know. But I could see in the final hospital buildings that there is, for me, it was as a visitor, there was a lot of positive experiences. And part of it was this art and good architecture quality. There was a very nice and calm experience, like a really good hotel you could maybe consider. And yeah, in the last case, healthcare innovation lab. The focus was kind of also on the need, but the talks were often anyway about the experiences. So when they were talking about when we were drawing those models, so there's a need of a toilet, but then what would be the experience of a patient or doctor coming from here to here? So there was experience in all of them anyway, in all of the cases.
Yeah. I think that would be also a good adding to your model, that if there is some kind of weightening, so if it's like need-driven discourse or experience-driven mm-hmm. discourse, or if it's in balance mm-hmm. in different phases as well.
Yeah, I did not divide those two in the paper. Yeah. Kind of thought about this is kind of one of the same, but of course there is some difference.
So. Coming back to your research questions, you have done lots of reading and literature studies. So how did you kind of identify the research gap from the theory? How did you choose that these are the questions?
Yeah.
And there is not yet enough research.
It was kind of double. On one, I had my supervisors, they could help me defining where is the gap. There is not so much written about that. So I had some ideas what I want to study. Oh, that maybe you can write more about. So of course that was the beginning. And then later when I was digging into the literature study, then I could see, okay, that is true. There is not so much on the other researchers focus only on a little part. I am focusing a little bigger part. So in that way it took of course some time, but it was of course a help of the supervisors too.
What about emerging of your research questions? You have changed many times the title of the name or title of your PhD during the process, mm-hmm. which is the way how it's usually going. So how did you kind of identify the research questions, and did you change them a lot during the process?
No, not so much. Actually, many of them stayed pretty much the same, the research questions, but I did adjust them a little bit, especially in the last phase here where I could see that part I'm answering very well, and that part I'm not answering so much because I didn't get any data about this subject. Yeah. So I did adjust them in the end too, but I didn't change them so much during the process.
All right. So let's think about this process still. So in all scientific work and research, you have to exclude something and include something and focus on something. So what did you decide? What are the decisions you made during your research process?
Yes, that is a very good question. It was very, very difficult for me to exclude. And Per maybe could say especially because he often was telling to me that I should kill my darlings and not go into so too many paths, which I often did not listen to. So I killed only a couple of darlings. And that is why it's so complex. My model also, it includes four different activities. It could be that I'm only focusing on evaluations or only on user involvement and how they help on the briefing process. But it was so difficult for me to not have them because it was already from the very beginning looking like those many subjects can add some extra value when combined. So therefore it is maybe, you could say, some of the other PhD studies are focusing much more deep into one very narrow field, whereas my field topic is a little broad, so maybe I'm not going super deep in each of them. But on the other hand, I hope that combine all those theories and case studies the same way can give something valuable. But I did kill some of the topics which I just shortly mentioned in the thesis, and I didn't mention at all today. For example, the evidence-based design that many ask me about if I have it, because of course hospitals, they, you need to have all the newest fancy things. So I did explain it a little bit. The evidence-based design is where when you design, then you take decisions about things that you know that work because some others have been researching. And often in the United States, and the focus is very clinical and like medical research oriented, where they, for example, prove that while looking at a tree, the patient, after so and so many trials, maybe after 3,000 patients, they could see that those that see a tree behind the window will spend one less day in the hospital, all of them. So that will be often the focus. But of course, we can say that this is what I'm saying, do some evaluations before you do the design, could also be evidence-based design, because there's evidence then this or that solution is working better, then let's choose that solution instead of another. Yeah. So I didn't dig very much into that subject. I just mentioned that very shortly.
Yeah, but I think that's very important for you in the future in academic career, mm-hmm. to think about this decision making and killing your darlings and focusing. Because to be honest, there is a lot in your research, and sometimes it's like a little bit lacking that what is this piece of puzzle? So what is the big picture, mm-hmm. which in the end is in the model. Mm-hmm. Model, of course, but that's important that you can reflect back to that. A few questions about chapter number 2, research design and research process. So, you have been using this research onion, and actually I was, well, can you take the research
sure.
onion here? So, why do you state, you did state in your presentation that your research is longitudinal?
Only to some extent, because of course most often the big longitudinal study, for example, continuing for 10 years, that I didn't have that long time. But I was coming back to the SMID case study, even though it was maybe, let's say, a Bispebjerg hospital. I started in 2010, before they even started the briefing process, so I could talk with the managers about what are the plans for the process that will start soon. Then I could observe the process of both briefing and user involvement. Then I was on a maternity leave. Then I came back and saw what happened after since last, and could continue. You could say, all in all, it was a process that took a couple of years.
So you were able to follow
yeah.
your data,
yes,
data and sample actually in the long, long mm. way. Good. And then could you please take the picture of this triangulation? This one and
yeah.
Okay, let's start from there. What is this green and what is that yellow in this Flick Uwe picture up there? That
yeah,
one, yeah.
That was just a little graphical way to show that there is a triangulation of both data and methods.
All
that
right.
each of them is, and then we have the green one here and the yellow one here.
Yeah. And if you can get back to the screen, why the expert interviews are there? Why they are not in the middle? Why they are not in the in-between of BH and
yeah.
Norwegian case? Why they are there?
Yeah, there is a reason, actually. So in a way, it could be in because that's one of the other methods. But I chose it a little on the side because those three are case studies. And this is not a case study. So it is a different data source.
Yeah.
You could say it's a different method, but it's also kind of different data.
All right.
So it's a little, yeah. So it is in, but it is a little away.
All right.
I couldn't show it in a better way.
Yeah, because this is kind also like if you stare at the picture, you can think that you have done expert interviews connected to this case, case healthcare innovation and case St. Olaf's. And
but, yeah.
That's it's kind of maybe a misleading because you don't mean that.
That's a good one. Because I also have expert interviews in them. But this is additional expert interviews that are not from the cases.
So actually you are mixing a bit that there are like two, three cases where you have data with different methods, which is triangulation is about. And then you have one more additional data. So maybe it should be maybe in the next yellow where it is. And this is also very, very much in it. And for this very like analytical thing that you have used this model and you have used this triangulation, why do you need triangulation for your research and for your PhD?
I don't need, I chose to do it because of this.
Okay. Is it connected to reliability and validity?
Probably, yes.
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 Yes, because
so more data coming and showing the same direction, it's probably true.
Yeah.
I believe what I see.
Exactly.
I could say.
Yeah, and because you have qualitative method and the role of researcher is there always subjective, mm-hmm. so you need to validate it in one and other way and also to improve the reliability.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that it's like really important to get deep into the deep understanding why triangulation is there, because you need reliability and validity in your research. And then it might help also to understand how to make focus the thing, because now like it's within these different methods you can get more data, but is the data going to the same direction? Is it showing and indicating that, yes, this is something what you can talk in a general manner?
Mm-hmm.
So I think this is very important part of your PhD to really apply it, not only as a nice model that this is and these mm-hmm. things suits nicely there, but what does it mean? How is it improving your academic research results?
Yeah, the next step would be, of course, to, if I have many more years to do this project, to apply it, to like plan and apply it on purpose, the model, and see what happens then.
Exactly, yeah.
That would be kind of testing. So I kind of only did that to some extent because I was testing before I was making the model where I was observing the cases. So there's some things going on in the brain. I don't have a proof that they designed that and then what happened.
Yeah.
We just saw what happened.
Exactly. And that is another thing to validate your model, but another thing is also that the data, which is the basis of your model, that it is valid mm-hmm. and reliable. So I think this can be used for both methods.
But I tried to kind of answer that by having many cases simultaneous and some extra expert interviews.
Exactly.
Are they saying the same what I see?
Yeah. Exactly. And that's the main idea, that you can kind of getting the saturation mm-hmm. out of there. So now I'm giving the word for Geir, but before that I will have you one triangulation question. Do you love or hate triangulation? What is your relationship with that phenomena?
That is changing because when I first heard about it, I thought, I hated it. But now, actually, when I used it, it's a good way of designing what I did.
Exactly.
Because otherwise it could look like chaos. But no, there is actually a meaning to it.
Exactly.
So now I maybe don't love it, but I think it's very useful.
Starts to be like a good friend, but not too close.
So
let's see if you love or hate theories. So I think that it's time for Gabe to take these questions. Thank you.
I have to put this on me. Yes. First of all, I will say thank you for being here, to be invited to the assessment committee, and for a very good and interesting overview of some of your work. And it has been a lot of reading and a lot of work for me. My background is architect, and I also worked as an architect, both professionally, but also for some years in the Faculty of Architecture and Fine Art in Trondheim. And my interest has been in the same area as you, as in design, architectural management, in programming and evaluation of building and use, in space management, and also the last 10, 15 years involved in usability of workplaces. So I know this field very well. I'm also from Trondheim, so I know this case, Sankt Olav, very well, because I was researching the phase one of the planning process, the early phase of that hospital. So that can also sometimes be a sort of pity for a PhD candidate. Yeah, okay, what have you really discovered in that case?
You know much more than me about the case, I'm sure.
Well, but also it's interesting because now I studied that in the early phase, and now you have looked on this hospital after it has been finished. So that's also give another insight. Well, the thesis is based on a collection of articles and actually five publications. And an article-based thesis has its strengths and limitations. On one hand, you can have the possibility to really dig into something and to limit the scope for each article. And also dig into some specific topics and problems. And on the other hand, the amount of pages are very limited. So meaning that, for instance, theory often will be described quite superficially. So, however, the thesis, a sort of connecting all the different theories and literature from the different articles. And I will today comment mainly on the thesis, the main, and not on the article itself. Mm-hmm. But I think an interesting starting point to discuss the theory literature is the position, your position, as you describe in chapter 2.2. And you says that you were researching for an overarching theoretical paradigm, connecting the different aspects of your topics. And you ask yourself what type of theory could be used. It might be design theory, facility management, architecture, and healthcare, or others. So when you go back to your title, your first front page, can you do that?
Yeah.
It is interesting because you were asked to what are your interests, and you said everything, and you were asked for five key words, and you mentioned the five main key words that also reflect your choice of literature theory. But if you go back to the main heading and I ask you for just one key word, what key word would that be?
Yeah, usability.
Usability.
Yes.
Okay. That's also quite interesting because that's also a sort of, when you reflect on choice of theory and also the approach, what type, because as a sort of, you, nearly when I read your theory chapter, it looks like everything is equal important.
True.
And I think perhaps also you should try to find out what is sort of in foreground and what is in background. And in background is a sort of understand the topic and the context, and the foreground could really be a sort of focus of the discussion. So mm-hmm. when I looked at your heading, I also thought, okay, what is the keyword? What I think is very interesting. And I chose another keyword.
Mm-hmm.
So what would you guess what that was?
Maybe briefing.
No.
The user.
No. It's to improve.
Uh-huh. Yeah. Also. Yeah.
And also, is it could also reflect on some here also because of your choice of your research question and the theory. If you said, okay, you will have stopped here, usability briefing for hospital design exploring user needs and experience.
Yeah.
Could sort of be, okay, you could deal with that. But also here you have to improve complex buildings. So, retrospective, what type of other approach could have been useful for you or perhaps more relevant?
I think that is two different questions. Which one is more relevant and which one is more useful?
Yes, that's right.
Well, but if we try to combine them, and more relevant and more useful, if you asked me which one is the most important, and I did answer usability, which I don't show so much in the text, then I could have put all the others a little more aside, as you say yourself, and focus much more about the usability and what is exactly about the usability in all of those phases, because I do maybe go a little at the surface because I'm taking all of them as equal partners. Mm. That is correct observation.
Yeah.
So maybe, and the research-wise, it would be stronger if I did choose usability as the main. But I did choose the usability briefing as the kind of overarching concept, combining all those things I couldn't kill. And try to combine a lot of ideas. So that is a different research. Mm. Maybe it would have been better research, but it would be less fun for me.
Yeah. But also that's a sort of price you have to pay to be very broad. You also are not able to use the time to go exactly deeply.
Yeah.
You mentioned yourself, value management could be one approach.
Yes.
And also I think one other relevant approach could be strategic space management, or as you also mentioned, innovation as such. And then I will ask some question about the different chapters in your theory chapter. And the first is about usability. And in this chapter, you elaborate on the definition and understanding of usability. And you also have this figure, 8, at page 28.
Yeah, I'll try to. It is probably the same figure.
Yes. But first, also very partly that you answered the question from Suvi, which implication does a usability approach lead to, and what specific will a usability approach bring in that traditional briefing does not? That also was a total two questions, but...
Can you repeat the question?
Yes. What is specific with a usability briefing approach than a traditional briefing?
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
There is more focus on, and then we can choose, you could say all of it, but we can of course choose a little more focus, because just like I said, when we both do the workshops and when we do evaluations, we always have to choose a little focus. So we can either focus on efficiency, effectiveness, we can use on satisfaction, we can focus on culture. So, but if we kind of try to have as many of them as possible, that will be the usability, and what can usability add to the normal briefing process that is often not having many of them. Often there's mostly the space and economy, and not so much the satisfaction, well, to some extent.
Mm-hmm.
Often not, sometimes a lot about efficiency is effectiveness, but not always.
Mm-hmm.
Very seldom about experience. Mm-hmm.
That's, I think, is a good reflection also, and leading to the next question is what is usability really about? Because you describe the definition and also bring in the other type of aspect of understanding usability, but you don't necessarily or really go into the more key factors or the measurement or parameters.
Mm-hmm.
That what type of parameters or topics are under effectiveness or efficiency, for example. So I should really like to you to dig more into it, because it also gives us such a more precise understanding on what the briefing is about and what does it mean with those different headings.
Yes.
You have some examples of those keywords on efficiency, effectiveness and satisfaction. What should that be about?
So the those two, efficiency, effectiveness, I always mix them. One is about doing the right thing and the other doing the things right. Mm-hmm. And that can, of course, be, if I was focusing much more on usability than on all the other subjects, then I could also see, okay, what would be the measurable criteria?
Yeah.
What are the things that we kind of put it maybe much more deeply? But I say, now I say in my model, you should do it, but I'm not giving so detailed instructions.
Because I can look, yes, that looks reasonable, but what shall I do?
Yeah, yes. You need to go deeper then. You need another PhD student to take parts.
And that's also a part of the price that you have to pay.
Yes.
Because you have some very important aspect of briefing and process, and you discuss how to improve that in order both to improve the process but also the product.
Mm-hmm.
And then I really ask, this is interesting, but how should I do it? What type, what is this really about?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. We had an early effort on that in the Norwegian research on usability on a paper written by Arge Kirsten Arge in 2004 that really tried to see, okay, what type of parameters is about satisfaction, and try to also elaborate the different perspective of different users, and because some of the parameters are more to the users or to the client or to the owner, so that's also be came different type of measurements that is important.
Yeah, and if you talk about measurements, they can be both numerical measurements, but it can be also qualitative measurements.
Yes, and that's important. And also in the Norwegian work, we also struggled really to try to dig into the effect of the building, because all the other things, the satisfaction you can measure, and there's a lot of methods to do that, and also the more measurable use of space and so on. But the effect of building is really hard to dig into. So I think some of your work really can give a better understanding on that issue. And then to chapter 3.2, user involvement and user-driven innovation. And here we present in figure 9 an interesting overview of different approaches of user involvement in a framework with two axes.
Mm-hmm,
yes,
one.
That's, yeah. And another way of grouping and understanding all those methods is another figure that you have by Storvang.
Mm-hmm.
And you have, I think the work is very good describing where you can place different methods.
Mm-hmm.
But I really are interesting, what did you find out in the your study of literature of the experience of the different methods? Because in your empirie or your case studies, you have a lot of empirie describing what is working well, what is complicated, what should you remember and look on.
Mm-hmm.
But in your literature study, I think you just mentioned methods, but not really say this method is very good at that, but you have to remember that and that to really get the right effect on the method. So if you have some comments on that?
Yeah,
do you think it's a little unfair?
That must be one of those things that I did not do because I have so many topics. So I did not dig so much into it. I am aware of that.
Yeah.
So we have to go back to literature to study that more.
Mm.
Because of course I have some observation things that I can describe, but I didn't observe all the different methods.
No.
I observed only a number of methods.
It's also a huge number of efforts. And so going into analysis, the plus and minus for mm-hmm. every of those 52 methods is too mm-hmm. much to ask.
Mm-hmm.
But even I think it could be useful to you to also discuss and understand and perhaps also improve the methods that you were using in those case mm-hmm. studies.
But for example, I have a few observations that, for example, this applied ethnography was very used, I could see, in finding tacit needs, the needs that the users don't know they have. By walking after the nurse after 2 days, I could see plenty of user needs that she was not having satisfied, and she was not aware of that because she was working like that for the last 20 years.
Mm. But I think your case study gives a lot of good examples, also giving support to your briefing model. And I think if you have dig more into literature, you also could find some more experience about the different methods used. So, but it's also sort of perhaps a little unfair because you have a lot done a lot of job to really map the different methods and try to group them in an understandable way. So now I'm just asking for even more. So it's a little unfair, but also giving a sort of good chance to reflect if you should work further on this topic, what could be interesting to dig into. As I said, I chose the word to improve as an interesting keyword because I also view argue that the usability briefing could be a sort of approach to really improve both the processes but also the product, the final building in use. And you also may mention innovation and can you perhaps elaborate a bit about your understanding of innovation as such and the main benefit of such approach in the briefing specifically? What is what does the understanding, what is innovation?
Yeah. Well, there is many different definitions of innovation out there. My maybe very quick definition now would be that there is a difference between innovation and just normal development. There is always some kind of development. And innovation is different in that way that it will be some unexpected additional development on top of the normal one. So you could say, is it innovation to make a new pen? Probably not. But if the pen could also have a watch, then maybe it is, because we didn't know we can have that. It's a just very simple explanation. But there's many definitions in the literature, but I don't remember.
No.
Right now.
And I don't think you write so much about those.
No, I think I write more about the user-driven innovation because that was my focus. Can the users improve the building, for example?
Because then
can
you
we do the,
quite interesting in the understanding and definition of on innovation on both product and processes and position and so on. And also because your work is partly innovation in process to look into what is going on, how could you approach the briefing and the design process in another way. And you have this usability briefing model as a sort of product process, innovation process perhaps, but also that this process will make some new solutions.
Thank you.
Yeah.
That sounds really good.
But if you think, do you have some reflection on what other factors that are necessary in order to achieve innovation in complex projects?
Yeah.
What other types of activities or framework or so on is needed?
Yeah, and then you have to tell me if you mean the just any kind of innovation or user-driven innovation, because there might be different things.
But basically user innovation, because that's what you have written
about. So I think some of the things I found out was that, for example, some people were asking, but I don't know if the users can innovate in healthcare when they all the time threatened to be fired next year. So there has to be some things that are, what can you say, is stable, so people are not threatened, so they can first then start thinking innovation. That would be one thing. And the other, maybe also the management, how can they actually leave the everyday job for a second and start thinking the future solutions. So the like strong management support and like, okay, now I'm going to innovate. Well, let's talk about what kind of hospital we want to be in 10 years or other building project. What kind of hotel we want to be in 10 years. That will also help the innovative.
So manage the processes is quite an important factor.
That's what I could observe. Those two things are pretty important.
Are there things that should be in place in order to be able to innovate from a user involvement perspective?
I was also thinking like the I was missing in one of the cases in the healthcare innovation lab. There was actually architects working on the same subject, just in a separate room. Like sometimes it could be connecting more different kinds of people, different professionals in a one place could help innovation, because each of them is used to different kind of professional words and thinking. And of course now, this time it was the medical staff that was asked to innovate in architecture. And of course some of the vocabulary was missing. It would be maybe even more innovative if the architect was there too. But then of course you might have some other trouble. There will be some power games, and but that you need to manage.
So what about organization, management, competences, capacity, resources, approach from the owner, and so on? What about those type of factors?
Of course, I think if you don't have resources, you will not get any innovation. I think it, that it is, and also my model is kind of, maybe for the critique, I'm guessing, would be that it's so time-consuming. It's so many different things we have to do. And maybe yes, and maybe you can apply half of it and still be successful. I'm just showing possibilities. But if you don't have capacity and money to do it, then probably it will not work out.
So that's also thought. Because I think it's very important to be aware of those factors to really success, to succeed. Because I think you are very focusing on the bright side of the life, all the positive possible methods and way of doing things, but also with a sort of other practice that this has to be in place to succeed.
Yes, but on the other side, I also do mention that you can overdo this user info. I mean, I was also met sometimes by the journal. Those that are reading the article, that you sound like you're in love with the users. You want to save the users.
Yes.
Well, in a way, I do, but at the same time, I did see that okay, you can overdo it. You can do 1,000 workshops with users, and the users would not be satisfied in the end. So you kind of have to do it the right way. And where is the right way? That you have to find out yourself. But maybe okay, if we do it a little structured way, invest some time to start with, then we maybe don't have to make 1,000 workshops, but 6. So that's, I think I'm trying to get a little balanced view on it, but I'm aware of that. I am in love with the users.
And then going to the briefing and or architectural programming, and briefing is both a process and a product, you can say. And you refer to quite a lot of different authors that have written about briefing, and also this briefing as a process, as something very important point in your work also. And you also go a little into what briefing is, and also the different type of needed information in the different phases of the design design process. And I think it's also a sort of reflection of what type of information is important and needed when in the process. And you have some also some reflection about that that is quite interesting. And when you come to practice, it's also sort of one part of your thesis that also could have been a sort of its own thesis in itself, because it's a lot of stuff in there too. What type of information, what type of boundary object, how to translate and transform this information from the first vague idea to documents and to the building itself. But you refer to one author, Yu. I'm not sure if that's the right pronunciation at all. And he lists 13 variables that have impact on the briefing process. It's on page 41. And then my tricky question is, which of the 13 variables do you think are most important related to your briefing model? Because you list up those type of variables, and I should really interest, what did you found most important to, and that also perhaps may influence your work on the development of the briefing model.
I have to look back in those 13 because I don't remember.
It's perhaps a little difficult for the audience to...
You have to bear with us. So yeah. I think, I don't know how many I'll choose, but I'll just pick some and leave some others. So I think pretty important is number two, stakeholder management. Yeah. Identify all types of stakeholders, consider their interests, devote time and effort.
I agree, and that also that's a sort of part of your founding, especially in St. Olav. So that's a sort of combination to combine both the theory literature and the empiry. Yeah.
And then maybe another one that I did not study so much, to some extent, change management. Client aware of impact of change, clear project information. Clear project information is very good. Mm. Appropriate stakeholder information incorporated at particular stage. That's kind of all those things I'm saying. I didn't call it change management. Mm. But pretty important. Post-occupancy evaluation, as it's part of my model.
Mm. What about decision-making?
To a big extent. Because you both have to make a decision before. What should the process include? Which kind of activities are we going to have at which... stadium, because you cannot just decide when it's too late, because that's what we see often in building projects, that we should have made some evaluation of best cases of our existing square meters portfolio. So sometimes some decisions are too late, so kind of, decision making and
okay, so we are not going to reflect on all, but sort of your first reflection about what you have read and how to use it and what is most important. Time is running, and I think we should also say something or comment on evaluation methods for facilities and this flower model. And you have really had also a lot of work to try to get an overview of possible relevant methods. And all those methods are related to evaluation of facilities. And my question is, what is the connection between the evaluation of facilities and usability? And you can pick up the flower model to just for the other to remember.
If I remember which direction, I think it was somewhere here. Yes
there. Because using this old from Vitruvius, one of his key was utilitas.
Yeah, which I say it's kind of the same as your usability, even though there is a small difference. Can you repeat the question?
Yes, because I was reflecting on you have mapped evaluation methods on evaluation of facilities, and you have developed this flower model to illustrate and to visualize that, and you place usability mainly in this corner, as you write.
Yes.
But you have some reflection about, is this really the only way, or is it a true picture? Does usability fit into other aspects?
You're thinking that maybe aesthetics could be part of usability, for example. Of course it could be. Yeah. It could be.
What about
now, if we kind of want to focus only on one or the other, then we can of course exclude some other parts. Mm. It's not the first thing when we want to look at usability. It's not the first to think about technical building performance, even though it can be part of it. Because if the building is not working technically at all, and if it's cold, then usability is going down.
Yeah.
So of course they are all connected.
Because here, because this is also sort of much more closer to. To the meaning of functionality and usability.
Yeah.
But in your first discussion about what is usability about, you bring into some other type of perspectives.
I had the simple experience in it. So, I see what you're getting.
Yeah. So this model is a sort of interesting in what you're doing, what you're saying. You have map methods, evaluation of facilities. But if you take another perspective,
you could say it's evaluation.
What useful is how could you?
We could call it evaluation of usability, all of it.
Yeah. But also because when you group those methods into this building phase model, it gives another another picture.
Yeah.
And also you mentioned some other interesting approach. It's that that you referred to, Per Anker. It's about people, processes, and places.
Mm-hmm.
And then it could be interesting to group or place those different methods in that type of frame and to see what is. It gives you some other understanding and some other use of how to pick relevant methods that could support usability in a sort of broader understanding than Vitruvius. Yes or no?
Yes.
Okay, thank you. and then design of hospital, that's your last chapter. And I wonder what findings specific relate to design of hospitals and what are more general findings related to building processes and complex projects?
Yeah, and here I kind of look at design as all those processes of designing what is going to be built.
Mm.
So kind of briefing is sometimes part of the design.
Mm.
They are interconnected activities. So in that way, the design is not only the engineering design or only the plumbing design or only the architecture design. It's kind of all those decisions. And hospitals is because, as I said before, all the cases. I'm sorry, I forgot already.
Yeah, well, it was a long, and I think try to finalize my comments also, I think, very important sort of backbone for your briefing model is the building phase model built on basic Ronit IBA.
Mm-hmm.
And you use very little space on that. Why?
On
why
the
so little emphasis on
phases?
Yes?
Yeah, because I found out that those are kind of national. And I come from Poland, and in Denmark, each country has their own. But many are very inspired by the RIBA, I found out.
Mm.
Also, when I saw that the Danish ones and the English one is almost exactly the same. So I thought, I will take this international one. I have to have some starting point. Mm. Knowing that in other countries, it might look a little different.
Mm.
And also in other building types, like in the PPP projects, public-private partnership projects, there will maybe be a totally different project to achieve the usability. So that's kind of the standard project.
Mm. But I think it could be also useful for you to go a little more into the different phases, the content, the actors, and also both the input and the output, and to really, because you are a sort of using that as a sort of important backbone, and you mentioned and describe some of those characteristics of the different phases.
Yeah.
Perhaps also digging a little more deeper into that.
Yeah.
But on the other hand, I now have said you should have, because I think it's a good opportunity to reflect on what are the potential in your work.
Mm-hmm.
And you have been able to connect different type of theory and literature and to put all those things together. And giving a sort of understanding of how complex such processes really are. And also that is often some of those aspects are really neglected in real process.
Mm-hmm.
So I think that's a sort of very interesting part of your work. And then it should be quite interesting to dig into all the different other parts. But perhaps there are some potential PhD students that can work on that later. So thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, then, yeah.
Yeah, like my name is Susanne Bersløn-Nielsen, and we've been working together for side by side in 5 years, and it's really nice. I'd like to say that in the beginning, that it's really nice for me to have this opportunity to go deeper into your work and discuss it. We've had many occasions to meet and have discussed facility management research across our projects, but this is, I've not been involved in the supervision sessions, and therefore there are many new things for me also when I'm reading your thesis mm-hmm. now. What I will do in my questioning now, and with the time that we have left, is to talk about your cross-case analysis and ask you questions about that, and also something about the practical implications of what you have been doing. Mm-hmm. So you are saying you have three cases, and you have like this cross-case analysis. So I'd like to invite you to say a little bit about why three cases? Why cases at all? Why these cases? Mm-hmm. Could you
start? So why cases at all? There's a couple of answers to that. First, that would be answering, well, this why and how questions that I found out. And I have how questions. How do we do this and that? Secondly, I had to learn something about hospitals, because when I chose the hospitals, then, and I was never working with hospitals before I started this PhD, then cases would help me dig into what is the environment, how the hospitals working, what are the building processes and design and briefing processes in hospitals, are they any different than those I know? Mm-hmm. And then finally, there's so many hospital projects right now in Denmark. So I thought, that is a good opportunity to see some new, fascinating, big building projects that are complex. And maybe there will be a possibility to get on board on one of them or more. And there was. So that was those three. Why case studies and why hospitals? Yeah, why hospitals was also because they are so complex. And I thought, That would be a good one. Mm-hmm. So choosing those case studies because they said yes, I could follow them to one another. And then why having three? Because they were so different, so I could focus on little either different phases or different approaches. For example, to patient involvement, the Danish and Norwegian had different side on that. So in a way, I could see some similarities and some differences. What's the whole question?
Yeah, no, it is about the case studies. Yeah. Yeah, they are giving some insight into reality. Yeah. And
yes.
And I assume that with your project, you want to improve the basis for improving reality.
Exactly. Yes. Real life. So I had to first learn what the reality looks like. Mm. What are the processes right now? What are the processes that work well? What are the processes that work less well? Mm. And see and combine those things in some essence.
And Sylvie has already been asking you about your process, mm-hmm. but how was it also with the case studies? Were they all there from the very beginning? Did you say, now I have to stop, now I have the ideal sample, or were you considering additional case studies? What made you mm-hmm. stop and deal with the three that you have right now?
Yeah, I think if I could, I would have taken six more. But the time, I could see, it's taking a lot of time. Just to go to one case, sometimes in the research process. As a PhD student, you'd not only have time for yourself, you also have to teach other students and read reports. Sometimes I found myself in a situation when I had a workshop to visit in Healthcare Innovation Lab, and then interview the director of the Bispebjerg Hospital, and coming home and reading 20 reports. Hmm. So in that way, I could not possibly take one more case at the same time. But at the same time, you could say I could add on later on, but at the process, even though it took 5 years, it was kind of, there was a deadline.
I understand. Everybody have to say that there is a certain limited amount you can do.
So I think,
but it's also about the quality of your research. Mm-hmm. How do the cases fit together? And what were your thoughts, your strategies in electing these mm-hmm. cases? And what are you therefore also standing with today?
Yes. So I think two of the cases, the Bispebjerg Hospital and the St. Olof's Hospital, are representing totally different ends of the building design project process. The Bispebjerg was at the very beginning with the briefing for the master plan competition, so not even going to each of the building, but just the master planning, or just master planning, so which of the buildings and departments would be together. And in the St. Olof Hospital, it was already finishing building when I was there. It was not completely completed, but it was kind of completed. And then I had to study them in different ways. Then I could observe and evaluate the existing building, and I could see the existing literature about them and reports. So in that way, they are not comparable in the same way, because I was not there when they were involving the patients. I could only interview people that were doing that, or read about that in the reports. But on the other hand, even though I cannot compare those two cases directly, they, because they are at the other two ends, give me more insight about all the building projects of hospitals in the world right now. So in that way, they were giving me more information. If I was just waiting for the Danish projects, I would have to continue the next 10, 20 years. So in that way, it was very useful to also have a project that is finalizing. And the last one, the Healthcare Innovation Lab, that one I have kind of by coincidence started, because it was already taking place before I started the PhD project. And I thought it was very, very inspiring and interesting, and both because it was doing things with hospitals, but also how to do this user-driven innovation. And they didn't know the answer. It was kind of, let's test different possibilities. So it's giving a different, let's say, a different view. But on the other hand, we were testing all of those methods, but it was combined with a hospital. So it was also kind of about hospital, but it was not about the hospital building project.
So what I want to discuss is also that your case study is giving you some kind of basis for the model that you're suggesting at the end.
Yes.
And that is why it is so important how these empirical studies of cases, how that is adding up and supporting what you are doing in the rest.
So each of them is adding some different things to the model. They are not completely comparable, that they all have the same method or phase, but just done differently. Each of them is doing something different.
So since your case studies are so important to kind of support the model that you are suggesting at the end, I'm very interested in reading, and we are very interested in reading your cross-case analysis. And we look into the chapter that has the title, cross-case analysis. And then we don't really know where to look, because we mainly find presentation of three cases. But the thorough comparison going across the cases, where, in your view, where can we look in your thesis and find what you have looked for and what you have found and what you conclude on that basis?
Okay, I have an answer to that one. For the first, I have a, a very, very short summary of answering that question on a page I will find in a second on a in a table. I thought it was just very easy way to combine them, because otherwise I can write that many pages about that, which I thought it's not not the
main. It is on page 90, or is it 89? It's around there. There, that is where you have the four, the three cases put into one table.
Yeah. 88 and 89.
But to me, that is only like a presentation of the cases. It's not an analysis where you look into specific issues that you like to investigate and discuss and comment and take into your model.
I see, but that is for two reasons. For the first, I cannot compare them directly, as I said before, because they are not doing the same things. They are in different place, or they are focusing on a different output. So you cannot compare them in that way. You can pick the things that they do and see that, for example, let's see, in the very beginning, you can just see that we compare which of the building phases they look at. The first one is looking at phase one, preparation brief, and two, concept design. The other case, Bispergobiler Hospital, is doing strategic definition and preparation in brief. Okay, we can compare a little bit. And then the case three, I'm mostly using phase seven. So in that way, you cannot compare them because it's something totally different. But you do can compare, for example, in if we look at the user types involved, we have the lead users in the Healthcare Innovation Lab. Mm. We have the medical staff in Bispergobiler Hospital, and we have the patients and patient organizations.
So there probably are something that so are I similar could, that could have...
I could have been writing have more about it in the text, but I thought that was a good overview, and then additional text.
For sure, it's a very good overview. But it's the next steps. It is what are you then concluding, and also the links. So my question would also be, if you could say a little bit what kind of, how would you explain the link between the cases and the model that you suggest at the end, the process model?
So if we look at this one. For example, here. I show here just very rough where the things in giving me data about which of the phase. So in here, in the case one, I could see there were over there, Bispergobiler Hospital in the very beginning, pre-project phases. Mm. I kind of, I was looking at a programming briefing, and one of the main things was the continuous user group. They started already there, and they're going to continue all the way, that group. The other groups are going just to be there and finish and do this collect input. So it's kind of giving me, and they were also doing evaluation, so it's kind of direct things from that case could tell me, okay, they are doing from the step from idea to strategic brief. They were also evaluating existing buildings and best practice. You could say I'll take directly from the case. They were also collecting input from the users and different kinds of user groups, but also the continuous user group that should continue. So that was a big, you could say it helped me build that model. In case two, I could see the different methods for co-creation, which I say you should co-create over there. And different design games and simulation. The simulation could be in the evaluate scenarios. That is a little over the gray.
But yeah, I see clearly how they are in different stages of the building process, and they have contributed. Yeah. So they kind of cover. So actually, I just noticed that then there is that gap in between where I'm wondering what your model is based on that. That part you could ask a little
I could quickly answer that. It is mostly the expert interviews. Because I could not see those phases myself. I could see it in literature and I can see it in reports from Sanctolo, but I haven't seen it.
Where is the kind of the evidence of your model?
So and the evidence is only partially, and the other, that is also what I say, the next step will be to test the full model.
Yes.
Not parts of it.
All right. I'd like to move on to a different set of questions. And that is where you've already been noticed that you're very positive towards user involvement. Mm-hmm. So now I'm going to play the devil's advocate. And I'm one only, really. My really heart is pumping for cutting costs, optimizing space, square meters and crowns. Mm-hmm. That's my field. So could you guide me to a way I can say that I have done user involvement, but I don't have to listen to the result, or the methods are easy to manipulate? You are showing a whole list of methods that can be used out of a good heart. Mm-hmm. But for me, that kind of person that I am right now.
Mm-hmm.
Are there certain methods that you could say that are specifically that they're different, and what makes them different? That's really what I'd like you to
the methods of
share.
User involvement.
Yes.
So for the first, if you care about money, you can't afford not involving users. Because if you don't, then you build a building that is not good, and you maybe build too many square meters or wrong square meters, not connected well enough. So that will be one selling point to the money person. Mm-hmm. Another, this with how much energy it costs with having all those user involvement meetings. I'm saying actually that's quite okay. We don't need 1,000 workshops. We can live with 6. Let's plan them well enough. And you do have to pay to all those people that have to take a few hours away from work. That is also a cost. But you will earn them later on in the better building, improved building.
And then with the methods, are they different in I mean, you are also using that whole diagram.
But those methods are not for the money person. Those methods are for the users and facilitators. In a way, there will be a different method to involving you, because you maybe only understand money.
Mm.
But I can still use a different method with the users,
If the norm is that nowadays you can't plan a hospital without user involvement.
Yeah.
So I have to have some, but I'm really not truly interested in the result.
I see. And of course, as you said, it's easy to manipulate. You can invite some users and they have nothing to say. Mm. That's a waste of time and money.
But could it be that all these methods could be misused in the way that
of course they can. They can be misused, all of them. The method cannot save the bad process.
So what is it that is important if you want to do it out of the good heart and bring the good results?
Yeah, convince the management, the people with the money.
Mm.
Convince them that it's a good business. It's a good business because they will save money, because they have a better building. They can attract more patients, maybe from other hospitals. The people are not getting sick. They don't have to pay them.
Mm.
Like, not just the patients, but the people working in the hospital. They enjoy working by them. They want to stay longer.
Mm.
That kind of thing. So it will be
some of the benefits that.
Yeah, I think it will be convincing the people deciding.
And then I would add that it's also about building the whole reliability and the trust and the legitimacy about the workshops.
And then you can, of course, discuss how many of them should be there.
Yeah. Very, very soon we're going to start a new PhD, and that's going to be about methods for improving the operational knowledge into buildings and building and briefings also. But what if we want to study effects? I find, what you have achieved is to make this whole collection of methods, but you kind of stop when the methods are there and don't study the effect of each of the methods.
Yeah.
If you are going to design and advise us on how to design this effect study, what would you recommend us?
Well, I thought also, I said before, that it will be the next step will be to test the model. Like, okay, if we do want to apply some of those methods and in those processes, to test what happens, especially, for example, in those phases. What would be the effect of those things? That I kind of only know because people told me. I didn't see that, so it would be a nice study to see if somebody can follow a project from beginning to end or from half to end or something like that. But what are the methods? It depends, of course, of what do you want to study. If you want to study the effects on the, how was it? The
operational knowledge into building phases.
What are the methods for adding that knowledge, or what are the methods to evaluate the
effect? So how do you know if it was worth it to, you invest in a process and you go through it, and how do you evaluate the outcome? How do you study it and then see if it was worth it? If you had some ideas about it.
I don't.
Yeah, no. One answer could be to study it once after they are conducted. I mean,
yeah,
the
but
ideal,
to study what?
The ideal would be to have and something that are comparable in a way.
I see the problem with the something. What is exactly the cause of the results we study?
Mm.
Is it what we did or is it some other things?
Mm. Yes. A classical dilemma in the search
yes.
and a difficult one. All right. So that was a little bit about, the methods and
mm-hmm.
how they can be used and also the risk of misusing them
mm-hmm.
In that process. And I guess it's important to put both the strong and also
yes.
the attention to what one should be aware of if you're going into these methods. And you can say that you have basis to write a whole book about methods. And continue working
mm-hmm.
on putting more description into what do you actually do
mm-hmm.
and what are the pitfalls and
yes.
how can you evaluate it and give examples of,
mm-hmm.
of what could be the outcome. My next question is about, it's a reality. In the Copenhagen region, there are 10 big hospitals and they are now starting a central FM organization that are kind of going to be the strategic
mm-hmm.
organization of all the hospitals. Mogens Kornborg is leading it, and he is in the process of building this organization.
Mm.
So you
he
must
should,
be.
He should read my thesis.
Yes, yes. And what if you had the possibility? You could borrow him for a couple of 10 minutes or a couple
yeah.
of hours, why would you say that it is important to have your expertise in-house?
Because I have been, many others know things about hospitals, but I do know how to involve users and get valuable knowledge that you can use in next phases in the briefing and design. And that it is all based on real cases and real expert interviews. So it's not only things I was hoping for when I was starting the PhD to
mm.
find out, but also things that, okay, reality tells us that if you do this, you might end up this way. It is possible to make processes to improve. Now I have to be careful what I say, improve what, because I cannot completely say improve the building, because I haven't seen the finishing, but I hope you can improve the final buildings, so improve the usability of hospitals.
Yeah.
And
then what if he says, well, that sounds very, very good and
mm-hmm.
very interesting, but I'm sorry, it's too late. The hospitals have already been ordered. The briefing process is out. It's done. Now it's about taking things into operation, so I don't need that.
Oh.
Then what would you ever try?
I would say that never too late. You can always improve some of the, maybe you did some things wrong, but you can always improve some of the next processes and don't make it even worse, but improve the next process. For example, do remember about the soft landings. Do evaluate the new buildings and adjust. There's still time for many different things. And at some point, as I show here with the arrow, start again. There's always some rebuilding in hospitals, moving.
So it's an ongoing process, and it's
so
not just...
It's not just in...
Once in 100 years when you order a new hospital or something like that. Yes. Thank you. And my final question here to wrap things up is, we've been talking about... We have really enjoyed reading your thesis and discussing what were the good questions to ask you. And we see a lot of interesting things in your thesis. But my final question on behalf of all of us is, what are you really most proud of in the process that you've completed now? 3 years in a thesis and study and with the results you have today, what are you the most proud of?
I'm proud of that I am finishing. I'm proud of that it was possible to combine all those very different cases into something that makes sense. That was sometimes a painful process to find out, okay, I know all these things, but what? So what? okay, we can actually build something new and usable for something. I'm really proud of that. Yeah, that I can add something to the community, research community, and maybe to the practice community too. I really hope so. So that I'm proud of. Yeah.
All right. Thank you very much. I don't have more questions.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much to the proponents, Suvi, Gaia, and Susanne. And thank you also very much to you, Aneta, for standing up against the questions, sometimes tricky questions, in a good spirit, and not even coming close to fainting, as far as I can see. So that was very nice to observe that. I haven't had any requests from the audience, ex auditorio, but I'm sure that you are prepared for any comments or short, very short questions, if there are any. Even from the supervisors, if you think you feel like that. You're also welcome to talk to Aneta afterwards. I don't see any hands, so now I think we will just give you and the opponents a hand.
Mm-hmm. Thank you.
And going into the third part of the defense, now the examiners will meet to finalize their assessment. Everybody else are invited to gather in the lounge outside this room and to enjoy the modest reception buffet while waiting for the result or final verdict of the examiners. I'm told that it will not take too long, but let's see what happens. this is the situation right now, so thank you very much once again, and let's meet outside.